Callan FM on 105 FM.
Where on earth are you from? We're from Wales. Where you come from? Do you put the kettle on?
Callan FM on 105 FM.
Kick it.
Robinson, you're trying to seduce me.
And you will know my name is the law when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
You ever seen a grown man naked?
Here's Johnny.
Life is a box of chocolates, Forrest. You never know what you're gonna get. Tell me about it.
Town. How are you on this fine afternoon? Everybody well? Jolly good. My name's Andy Snowden, and this show's all about music from stage and screen and anything you might have seen on your television box. Good afternoon. Well, today we're going to have a very special day. The European Championships are almost over, and we're going to have a little bit of a recap on all events that have taken place in France over the past 4 weeks. And I have invited back four of my very good friends to join in with a debate that we're going to be having later on. We have Mr. Rob Walsh, Councillor for Sligo. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Andy. Thank you for inviting me back.
It's a pleasure, lad. It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure for me, too.
And, here he is, Craig Jones. How are you, sir?
I'm very good, Andy. Thank you for having us back again.
Marvellous. And you're a good lad. George Jones, get to the mic.
I'm good, thanks.
Oh, good lad, all right. And of course, we've got my daughter as well, Rebecca Snowden, who's going to be starring in Dancerama at Theatre Clwyd this time next week, actually. And we'll have a little bit of a chit-chat with her a little bit later on as well. Good afternoon, Rebecca.
Hey.
Oh, you can hear her. There she is. So, did you enjoy the football? Have you had a rather good week? Did anybody go and see the Stereophonics last week? Did anybody go?
Yes.
Of course you did.
Comes and hurts her, lounging in
to the Andy Snowden Radio Show. Oh, he's gorgeous.
Stereophonics, The Bartender and the Thief. Fantastic. It's got to be their best one for me. Best one for me.
You're listening to the Andy Snowden Stage and Screen Show. It's just banter.
Right, here we go. French music as well. Bonjour, gentlemen. Oh, no, monsieur, 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 and madame. There you are. Yeah. So I know,
bonjour,
actually.
Merci beaucoup.
It's only French I know. I can count to 10 as well. So, anyway, welcome back, lads. It's been a very, very short month, hasn't it? This,
it's gone very quick. Yeah.
Very strange, really, because some of the things, when you think back and you think, oh, that seems a while ago, and other things, I mean, you sat in here now. I think, yeah. God, that was a month ago.
Yeah, no, incredible. It's gone quickly, and a lot's happened over the past month as well, So a lot to talk about.
So for anybody that missed our show on the 10th of June, it was just as the Euros kicked off, and we had a great chit-chat about what our predictions, well, actually, what these two lads' predictions were. We have, I'll introduce them again, we have Councillor Rob Walsh.
Thank you, Andy. Yes, pleasure to be here.
I won't talk over you this time. And Wrexham fanzine, he loves a chat. I was actually looking on social media this morning, and these two lads introduced themselves. And let me just try and find what they said about each other. Here you go. Now they're looking nervous. Right. Now, Craig said about Rob. What is it? Oh, look, I saved it as well. Craig said about everyone's favourite councillor, Mr. Rob Walsh. Is that well, stand by that?
By everyone, but I mean a few people. But I was just trying to.
Cheers, Craig.
I was just trying to make him more popular. Just trying to big him up a bit, really.
Yeah.
As I do have to socialise with him now and again, so got to keep him in good spirits anyway. Yeah.
Bearing in mind, I can now change what you said about him. You said Wrexham AFC's chatter and Chilean Merlot drinker. Is that right?
Occasionally Chilean Merlot drinker.
Tell the full story.
It's in reference to actually at the Stereophonics gig.
Yes.
I saw the photograph.
I thought it would be a good idea to, rather than join the lager and cider louts, thought it would be a bit more classy and have a bottle of Chilean Merlot.
But
realised I had to drink it out of the bottle. So,
any plans he had to be classy were just thrown completely out the window.
He just looked like a homeless fella.
All that was missing was the brown paper bag and a park bench. I just thought I'd try and do a bit better, but it didn't turn out that way, really.
Is that what you were referring to, by the way?
Absolutely.
Right, okay. So before we go any further, tell us about the Stereophonics concert. Was it what you expected it to be? Do you think we should...
Well, it was actually very good. I actually wasn't meant to be going, but managed to get a spare ticket on the Friday night, the night before.
Like half of Wrexham, I think.
That's it. And there seemed to be lots of worries in the build-up about queuing for wristbands and...
Yeah.
All and people were going to be waiting for hours, but it actually, the organisation was very good.
Yeah.
Like, when I went to get my wristband, I just walked in and out and there were no queues or anything. Lots of queues inside to get to the bars, but it's only to be expected.
Yeah.
But it was a really good event. I know I shouldn't say this, but it felt like you weren't in Wrexham, I think, because you're not used to things like that happening.
I know what you mean, yeah.
So yeah. Well organised. Yeah. Used to those things, you know, sort of, where you have to travel far to.
Yeah.
But I think it went really, really well. The whole, you know, the day was good and it wasn't too packed, you know, as in they hadn't over, you know, sold too many tickets where you couldn't move or anything.
Yeah.
And everyone seems to be enjoying themselves and the Stereophonics themselves were very good and quite a few mentions of Wrexham. And I think... because it was the day after Wales had beat Belgium.
Spoiler alert.
Sorry.
Sorry, I think everybody knows.
Yes.
Go on.
And, can you imagine these people, what did Wales beat Belgium?
What day was that? I did think that, actually. I mean, I saw a few videos on YouTube and whatnot, and yeah. I thought... That really helped, didn't it? That helped get the atmosphere going. And
yeah,
didn't they start off with footage of it?
They start off with footage on the big screens.
Yeah.
Because, and I think if they'd have lost the night before, you know, spirits wouldn't have been as high.
Right.
So that really helped the atmosphere and helped the day. And, no, it was really good. And I hope it's something perhaps the race course could put on every summer, you know.
Well, that's Ashley Councillor. Is that something that's possible? Can it reckon it'll happen?
I wouldn't know, to be honest with you, but I agree with Craig that it's certainly something I'd like to see happen, and I hope events like this can continue. I hope that we get some other prominent bands come into the town. So yeah, definitely a big success. I wasn't there myself, unfortunately, but I did drive through town on the evening, and there wasn't a soul about. So it just goes to show how much this captured the imagination. So I say more of it, please. Yeah.
I mean, I did hear that the Manics were coming. Is that true? Did anyone hear that rumour?
I haven't heard that.
I think with them being Welsh as well, there's been a few mentions. I think that would be prove again to be very popular, just like the Stereophonics were. But I think the scope's above anything on there. We could have, who knows, ballet, opera.
You know, the funny thing is, I know we're supposed to be talking about the football, but yeah. We got 2 hours to fill, don't worry about it. In the William Aston Hall there, I mean, we have such really good acts coming here now. Yeah. I mean, a couple of years ago, I met you there, didn't I? We went to see, who did we see? Jimmy Carr,
yeah.
And, he ripped into me, which was the most bizarre thing.
Unusual, that.
I know, it was bizarre, because I thought, oh, God, I hope we're not sitting, I didn't know where we were going to be sitting, because a friend of mine had the tickets. And so when we got there, and I thought, I hope I'm not sat at the front, because I work with children, and you can imagine what he would say to me. Anyway, our tickets were sat at the back, and at some point in the concert, he just said, does anybody, you know, do we have any actors? And my wife, in her wisdom, just went, over here, Jimmy! And then, do you remember? And it was the most... I felt like I was sat in my underpants with the spotlight on me. It was really freaky. But I said then, you know, I mean, if we can get the likes of Jimmy Carr coming, who fills theatres all over the country, we can get anybody. And since then, you know, I'm not saying it was my fault or anything. Since then, it's just gone from strength to strength. And we've had, you know, all the big names have come here.
Yeah.
And so weirdly, not going to Theatre Clwyd, which kind of sort of holds the same amount of numbers of acts. Theatre Clue is in a bit of a mess financially. Do they could do better than...
Yeah, well, that's Flitcher, so not my problem.
We'll wait till we start talking about England. This is going to get dodgy. Yeah. I definitely think we should have more concerts like it. I think they put it on well. I don't, you know, it was
definitely
virtually trouble-free, I presume. There was no messing.
Yeah, there were a few domestic, I think, between... husbands and wives and boyfriends and girlfriends, which is really? On the way back.
Oh, lovely.
I think most of the trouble seemed to be because nobody could get a taxi afterwards.
That was the only downfall, wasn't it? Am I right in hearing that the last train out of Wrexham was 10 o'clock and it didn't finish at 10?
It was, yeah. And the queues in McDonald's afterwards were horrendous. You know, they should have thought about this before before the night.
Brilliant. All right, listen, chaps, tell you what we'll do. We'll have a little bit of music and then we'll get back to talking about Euro 2016. What a month it's been. It's been an absolute belter. Don't bring me down. Fantastic. Did you see him at Glastonbury? Did you see him doing what they do best? I said I went to see him in Manchester's Manchester's arena there a couple of weeks ago. Possibly the best thing I have ever seen in my life.
Callan FM on 105 FM. Uniting our community.
So anyway, let's get back to talking about the football. Here we go. So Euro 2016 finishes tomorrow and it's been one hell of a month of football. I've got to ask the lads though, first things first, BBC or ITV, what do you like best?
Oh, BBC, always been the case, yes. Yeah. So no, I've never been a fan of ITV football. I suppose they've always insisted that they share the coverage, but no, it's no brainer for me. It's a far better commentary, far better pundits, no brainer. And it'd be interesting to see how many people actually watch the final tomorrow on ITV. Yeah, I'm sure you could count them all on. I'll be generous on two hands.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I agree with Rob. I've always preferred BBC coverage. I think the viewing figures tomorrow night will show that as well. I think I've always hated the adverts on ITV. I think that's the one advantage BBC have not.
Mm.
But they put adverts on at the most inopportune moments.
Yeah. Yeah, was it the Wales-Portugal match the other day when it was on ITV? And I went straight onto social media and I said, once the teams are out and they've done the national anthems and everything, don't go to an advert break. What's that all about?
Yeah.
You know, and I think they only did two adverts or something. I mean, those people must have paid a lot of money for those adverts to go out.
This is the thing, because they get they pay the money. It annoys me when adverts come on when the players are celebrating on the pitch after.
Yeah.
You know, they're celebrating in front of the fans.
Yeah.
You, as viewers, you want to see that.
Yeah, you want to see it all, don't you? You want to experience it all.
Exactly.
You don't want to know about.
No, but the coverage has been pretty good. There's been a few dodgy pundits. I don't think, as much as a servant as he was to Manchester United, I don't think Ryan Giggs will be getting...
No.
No. I think
it's like the World Cup with Neville, wasn't it?
Yeah,
Phil Neville, yeah.
It wasn't. Yeah, Gary Neville's excellent as a pundit. Very good,
no, okay. Yes. But Ryan Giggs has made Michael Owen look interesting after this.
Yeah.
So I think some people just aren't cut out for it.
No, yeah. I think that's very true. I want to give mentions. I think Slaven Bilic has been a fantastic pundit. And Dean Saunders as well. And
he's
done well with the heavy burden of this parking fine and lack of clean clothes. So.
Well, did you hear what they did for him? They put it on Twitter. For anyone that doesn't know, he's been going on about his parking fine. He was supposed to go out for three games. And he was there for, five games?
Mm-hmm.
And so Cardiff Airport tweeted, we're going to waiver his... mind you, I can't imagine him getting to the desk and going, right, look, I've got this Twitter here.
Yeah.
Someone tweeted me saying it's free. No, I don't think so. Yeah, I completely agree with you. I tell you what I find weird. Roy Keane, when he's a pundit,
mm-hmm.
and... whatever he seems to say, he's a bit like Simon Cowell. Mm. Everybody else can have their say in it, but the minute whatever he says, everybody kind of agrees with it. It's a really weird thing. It's almost like they're a little bit scared of him. They probably are.
Yeah.
But I quite like him. But you know, if he goes, you know, Rooney was rubbish, then Rooney was rubbish, in my opinion.
Yeah,
if everybody says Rooney was rubbish, and he goes, oh, actually, I think he had a good game. I just think, well, maybe he did. I don't know. I'm not arguing with Keane. But on the whole, did you enjoy the whole experience of the tournament?
I thoroughly enjoyed it. Yes, no, it's been as tournaments go, you usually tend to get the better games earlier on, and then the later games become tighter affairs. But mind you, a couple of the quarterfinals thoroughly enjoyed, and we had obviously France Germany the other night.
Yeah.
Excellent. So I think it's been one of the better Euro tournaments. So I did say that this had the potential to be the best of all time. Whether it is, I'm not sure, but it's up there, and definitely the increase of 24 teams is very much welcome. So I've enjoyed it. Yeah.
Yeah, I've enjoyed the new format with the 24 teams. I don't think it's harmed the quality. I did hear this morning, actually, UEFA are going to review to see if the 24 teams did work. I can't imagine them going back to 16 how it was before.
Yeah, seemed all right. It actually did work. I mean,
exactly. I think it's been... There seemed to be... a lot of people seem to have problems with this third-place side qualifying and who was going to play who, but it all sorted itself out in the end.
Yeah, can I just come into that? With the third place. Yeah, again, a lot of people say they don't understand it, they think it's wrong, but I think it's worked very, very well. And I think in previous tournaments it's worked well also, because I think if you can still qualify as a third place side, that means that every match in the group counts. Because I've seen many tournaments, particularly in the World Cup, where when you come to the last set of group matches, teams are either out who have definitely qualified and the matches are pointless, and therefore you can get a result which is slightly skewed, and that can affect the final table. But I think this way, I think I can only think of one match which meant nothing, But on the whole, every match there was still something to play for, and I think that's vital. And also, if you remember my anorak fact from last time about a third place team,
well, I thought you were going to mention the Bjork thing again.
Yeah. the third place team in a group going on to the semi final or final, it's happened again.
Yeah.
Portugal finished third in Group F and now in the final. So that's the third time that's happened in a row. From 1994, Italy did it. 1990, Argentina. And the only other time we've had a format like this, 86, Belgium finished third in their group and got to the semi-finals. So it just goes to show that every time a third-place team progresses. So it's worth keeping this format, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely.
I agree.
Yeah, you agree with that?
Yeah, I think so. I think, as Rob said, it makes all the group, all the games in the groups important as well. One thing about the tournament that hasn't been mentioned, but I think there's a reason it hasn't been mentioned, is... I think how good the refereeing's been in this tournament.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it hasn't been talked about, I always think that's a good sign, because there's been no... As far as I can remember, there hasn't been any real controversial decision. There was perhaps the penalty France got the other night with a handball, slightly dodgy.
Yeah.
But unbelievably, we've had 50 matches. There's only been 3 red cards, which... is unheard of. It we've had tournaments in the past where there's been 3 red cards in the first week.
Yeah. And also as well, the players seem to, I don't know if something had been said, but normally in a Premiership match, if the referee says something, then there's a little bit of an argument, a little bit of argy-bargy. Referee says, go on, off you on your way. But it was almost like the players were playing like rugby players. Yeah. The referee sort of like do eyes like your mum and sort of go, no, Stuart. And then they sort of like, they just backed off and just cracked on with the game.
Yeah.
You're right, though. I mean, when the games all seem to flow really well.
Can I just say, I agree totally with Craig there. I think the refereeing has been excellent.
Yeah.
And I think even the standard of the linesman or assistant referees has been good. But what one bone of contention I do have is these goal line assistants. And I've got to be blunt. What the hell are they there for? I mean, there was the incident when in Wales, Slovakia, when Thomas Skirtle brought down, was it Jonathan Williams, virtually dragged him to the ground.
That's where he elbowed him in the face.
Him to the face, yeah. So, but I remember that, and the goal line assistant was right there. He didn't even see anything. I think, well, what's the point? Is it just to make sure any potential goals which are just on the line are either given or not given? But we've got Hawkeye technology for that now.
Yeah.
So I can't understand. I just hope they're not being paid too much for that job.
I know, it's a pretty bizarre thing. Because I'm quite surprised they're still using them. Because when they first brought them in, it was almost like an experiment. Yeah. Well, it was almost shut people up who kept on going, we need goal line technology, we need something to just say that the
ball's...
And then they went, all right, well, we'll have a ref on the line there. I don't think really anybody outside of FIFA thought it worked, or UEFA. Yeah. And there they are, still there. It's weird. You're right, you're absolutely right.
I know, I hope I'm put a curse on it now, because we just praised the refereeing. because the English ref, Mark Clattenburg's got the final.
Has he?
Tomorrow night.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, that was the one thing he was told, he would get the final as long as Wales didn't beat Portugal, because... he wouldn't have been able to ref it with him, even though he's English, Wales obviously being from the United Kingdom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So he was probably happy Portugal beat Wales. So him and his team get to ref the final. And I just think there's been no bad decision. I mentioned that it's probably going to happen tomorrow night now.
Yeah, completely agree with you. Right, we'll have a little bit of music, and then we'll come back with your predictions that you gave just under 1 month ago. Mm-hmm. You nervous?
No.
I've seen you've got your wall shut here, Andy, with all the results in. So I'm
just very neat as well. Only a couple of mistakes.
I'm just going to pretend they were my predictions, actually. So
well, this is why I've recorded them, pal.
FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
chance you got.
Monkey. So here we are, Callan FM, 1:35 p.m.
Callan FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
Let's go over to location 3. That's Wrexham, the Glyndor University Sports Centre. Hi, everybody there.
Oh, there we are. So, I'm just playing with all my jingles today, just showing off in front of the boys. Anyway, so, as I say, one whole month ago now, these boys, Rob Walsh and Craig Jones, and young George Jones as well. Let's not forget this young lad sitting here. You all right, pal?
Yeah.
Enjoying yourself?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll send you to the shop in a minute. You can get some sweets. You can go and get some refreshments. What they did, they came and did a show for me, and it was absolutely belting. But what they did do, of course, before we ended, we had some predictions, and I'm going to play their predictions now, just to embarrass them, really, and we'll see how well they did. Here we go. This is Group A, and it involved, read them for me, France, Romania,
Albania and Switzerland.
There we go. France, Romania, Albania and Switzerland. And this is what they thought. Here we go.
Basically, in terms of Group A, my view is, like France won last night, I think that they're by far and away the class side in that group.
Yeah.
We've got Switzerland, Albania later. We've had some shocks this past 12 months in the world in general, like Leicester winning the Premier League, Neil Hamilton making a political comeback. I think the biggest shock of all has been Albania qualifying. I never thought Albania would ever qualify for a major tournament, and I think that they were very lucky to qualify, so I could see them being root at the bottom, and I expect Switzerland to win this afternoon. So I expect France to win this group comfortably, with Switzerland and Romania following. I expect both Switzerland remain to qualify for the next round. So that's my Group A prediction.
I agree 100% with you there, Rob, actually, on that group.
Yeah.
What can I say?
Yeah, nearly right. I think the comments about France and Switzerland spot on, but I was probably a bit cruel on Albania there. Albania, I thought, did very well, and
they did
very
play
unlucky
well.
Not to get to the last 16.
They were actually a surprise package, really. They did actually play well in all their three matches, but we were off to a good start there. Both said France and Switzerland would go through.
Yeah,
but it
was fairly obvious.
Romania was pretty disappointing. Yeah. I thought Romania would do better, but fair play to Albania. They probably, on the balance of play, deserved points against France and against Switzerland, but wasn't to be. But they'll learn from this.
I mean, we were saying just before we came in the studio that it wasn't a massive goal fest, was it? Early doors at the in the first round.
It never usually is in Toast, because it's not like the Premier League, because the Premier League's played at a much faster pace, but these tournaments tend to be a little bit more cagey, and they tend to get more cagey as the tournament goes on, because basically if you lose a goal and lose the match, that's it, you're out. So that's why there is far more caution. But I think compared to previous tournaments, it's been okay, so I wouldn't be overly concerned about that.
No. But I think as well, in my mind, you know, when the World Cup's on, yeah, and there's sometimes it can be 6-7-0, and it's, yeah, you know, in Germany's playing Brazil. but you kind of forget that it's really, really poor teams. Probably countries like Iceland, probably, we've got more people in Wrexham. Against Argentina and teams like that, then you are going to get a massive goal.
It's not as bad as what used to be, because I think basically in the 70s, early 80s, you used to see teams, the top countries, batter the lower countries. But I think now it doesn't quite work like that now. And I know it's a cliche, but there are very, very few really abysmal teams in the world. So I think once you get to a World Cup or a Euros, you don't get those kind of scores. These tend to happen, say, in qualifying, for example, countries such as Liechtenstein, San Marino, Andorra, they're the ones who get the pastings. But at this level, it doesn't really happen.
No.
Mm. Right, okay, perfect. So pretty good start, early doors, although, as we say, France and Switzerland, it was a bit of a simple bet, wasn't it, really? Should we go for Group B? Yes. It was in Group B. Oh, the big boys.
It was the
semi-finalists. Wales, Slovakia, Russia, and
Group B is, of course, the one with both Wales and England in.
Yeah.
We discussed a bit earlier. I think even though they always seem to have trouble when they come to a major tournament, I think England will have no problems in this group at all. I think they've got a good young squad this year, so despite me being Welsh, I think England will top the group comfortably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then, really, for finishing second, I do actually think it could be anyone from the three. I actually think Russia will be better than Rob does, but I'm not 100% sure. Wales have got the potential to finish second, but I think any of those three could finish second, and then they'll be fighting out for the third place, hopefully.
I agree with Craig about England should win Group B, but then again, Wales could spring a surprise on Thursday, but I am not keen on Russia at all. I think they qualified from a very easy group, and I think in recent tournaments they've been abysmal. So I don't think they're a good side at all, and they would be one of my big nations to flop at this tournament. So yeah. I would expect England, Slovakia, Wales to go through from that group.
So,
Yeah, well, all I'm going to say is, Herb, that's the one, because I predicted that group right, and I told you Russia would be a flop, and I thought they were a very, very poor side, and but I was saying that group, Slovakia, I thought, very solid side. Wales did better than I thought. I thought they played a poor match against England, but they battled well against Slovakia, and what they did to Russia, superb. England, for me, were the best side in that group, and I think they played the best over the three games. It's just that, apart from the Wales game, they just couldn't score, and that was ultimately their downfall. But I think that the three who went through were the right three to go through, and fair play to Wales for topping the group and showing their spirit.
Yeah.
No, definitely. I think I sort of agree with Rob. England, their overall play in the group was pretty good, but the finishing was dreadful at times.
I thought England was going to walk it. I actually thought England might have a chance of winning this year. I don't know if it's because of their qualification being so good, but when you sort of look at their qualification teams they had to play, I mean, it wasn't really the most difficult teams in the world. But neither was this on paper, really. I mean, they should have done better.
I don't know if I agree with that, because obviously they had Switzerland in their qualifying group, and they had teams like Slovenia, but this was far stronger because Wales and Slovakia are good sides, and they're always going to give them tough games. And as I said, the waste of space in the group with Russia, but no, it was always going to be difficult. So I think the frustration for English supporters would be they dominated those three matches, and apart from the Wales match, they just couldn't score against Russia and Slovakia. But they did score against Russia, but then they went and conceded the last minute. So they should have had 6 points out from those two games when they only had two. So it was silly.
Well, yeah, let's just have a little recap of the England-Wales match here. Let's just punish ourselves.
Thought you'd find a way. Glad you could make it.
Come back, stick to the right, chest tucked down, and strike, and strike brilliantly.
There you go. Yeah, that was the England-Wales match. And I don't know. Even then, I thought, this England team isn't amazing, is it?
No, that's the thing. Just to talk about England and their tournament overall, I think virtually every time they qualify brilliantly, their qualification record must be better than anyone in the world, probably, to get into tournaments. But I think the problem always seems to be the same with whichever manager they have, and I think they're going to have a new approach. It seems as if, especially with Roy Hodgson did the same, he's put in players in who've done well for England in the past for him, but have been totally out of form for their club or even injured.
Yeah.
You look at players like Wilshere and Sturridge, you know, should they been out injured for so long and only just got back to fitness.
Yeah.
You know, you have to question if they should be in. And then it's a case which has happened because they've got such a crop of players to choose from. It's the old square pegs in round holes saying. Mm-hmm. Like, you look like a player like Jamie Vardy, for example, been absolutely outstanding for Leicester, but he's good in that position and in that system.
Yeah.
If he doesn't fit into the system England are going to play, then you can't play him.
Yeah.
And it's the same with lots of other players. Like, he played Sterling in two or three of the games.
Yeah.
And towards the end of the season, he was absolutely terrible. He couldn't even get the Man City side.
Yeah.
And it's the same with lots of players. And I think, you know, he thought, oh, I better put them in the squad because they've done quite well in the Premier League. But it's—I think you just need—you can only play them in the positions they play in the Premier League or wherever, because it's not going to work. You know, I think he's trying to fit players who haven't got a clue or have never ever played in that position. Like in the last game against Iceland, Daniel Sturridge was playing on the right up front. He's probably never played there in his career.
Yeah.
But he thought, oh, I'll just put him in because he might do something.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the problem with England in tournaments is it's more, oh, fingers crossed, it all gels together.
Yes, yeah.
But and I don't think, not just Roy Hodgson, previous managers, they seem scared of upsetting big names. You know, to me, I know Wayne Rooney's the England captain, but he was in no sort of form going into that tournament for Man United.
No.
And I know he's experienced, but I personally don't think Rooney's good enough to play for England anymore. But I think they're scared to drop big names. They always have been. It was the same with Gerrard and Lampard in the past.
Well, do you remember when Glenn Hoddle dropped Gascoigne?
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Oh, I remember that.
Basically, because he'd been on the ale the night before, so he just went home then. And there was absolutely... Glenn Hoddle needed, like, escorting out the airport when they came back for 5 minutes. And he's thinking, hang on a minute. If Gascoigne's not up to the job, then that's the manager's job, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, but the same thing with Hodgson this year. When Vardy was on the bench and Sturridge was on the bench, then they came on against England and scored, and then suddenly everyone's an expert.
Yeah.
And so why ain't you starting Vardy then? And they start Vardy, and
it doesn't work.
You know, don't start picking your team because the papers sell you to.
I know. Well, that's English football all over, isn't it? And has been for donkey's years. And I'd like to say that we'll see something different, but we won't, because I remember 24 years ago in Euro 92 when they decided their first match. They were going to play, I don't know if people remember, Keith Curl of Man City, a centre-half, brilliant centre-half, but they decided to play him at right-back for the first time in his life.
Exactly.
But the thing is, this happens every tournament, and they just never learn. And I just think, so like Raheem Sterling, I think there was also somebody set up... a fundraising page to pay for him to come home. But the thing is, the problem with Raheem Sterling is he's just all fancy footwork. He doesn't bring other players into the game. Yeah. So,
but that's it. As I said, the problem's always been you're bound to have a minimum of two good players who play in one position.
Yeah.
Well, you have to choose between one of those to play and not play the other one rather than... Oh, well, I'll play him in that position, but because he's quite good as well, I'll stick him out on the left or I'll stick him out on the right.
Yeah.
It does. They've done it for years and years and years.
Yeah.
And it just does not work. They go into tournaments without knowing what the best system is or, you know, I think you've got to have a first at 11 in mind. Just stick with it.
Yeah.
But it just will happen. It has happened and will carry on with England, I guarantee.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right. And you know, the fact as well that they were in the same group as Wales, so everybody sort of like set them off against each other. It was probably good for ratings on the telly and all the rest of it.
Oh, it was a great game, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I don't think Wales, it was one of their better games. But I think that when it came 1-1, I think they were going to settle for a point. But then they started defending very deep, and then it was only a matter of time before England went on and scored. So even though I think England probably deserved the 3 points of the day, I think that morally throughout the tournament, obviously Wales clearly deserved their progression far more than England did. Yeah. But it was a great day. It was just very sad that match was obviously... It was pushed off the news headlines by, obviously, the tragic murder of Joe Cox, the MP.
Yeah.
Because I think, obviously, if that hadn't have happened, then, obviously, it would have been a much bigger event, and I think people would have been talking about it for days afterwards.
Yeah.
But it was very much overshadowed.
But at the time, there was a massive uproar about the how biased the commentary was. Mm. You know, I mean, it was incredible. I mean, I don't... Mm. You know, you're watching... I was watching BBC Wales, and it was still... You know, I'll play this for you, listen.
How he's got through that sea of players, we'll never know. But who cares? England are in front.
Do you know what I mean? That's against Wales.
I know.
That's just unbelievable. I think the television companies, almost they were in a weird juxtaposition where they were like, well, a little bit like me, actually, because I've always supported England, because you know, who else was there to support, you know? And the next minute... England are playing really badly, and Wales are, well, quite frankly, brilliant. Mm-hmm. And then they had to sort of support them.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was that thing in the paper the other day, as you said before, you know, you made us all proud, and thinking they couldn't get a couple of columns 2 weeks ago. Mm. You know, when Wales beat Belgium. You know, the following day, there was a story on the front page about Vardy's misses.
Yeah, well,
what is this?
It's typical of the London-based media. They always ignore Wales, and to be honest, I think it's a disgrace.
Yeah. Okay. Should we have some more music?
Yeah.
I think we should. Anything you might fancy? Let's have a look what we got here. Oh, I know what we were going to have, and I've lost it. Oh, we're going to have George Harrison. Yeah. When was the last time you ever heard that? And there he is. That's What Is Life. Fantastic. Gone, but very, very much not forgotten there. George Harrison, fantastic. Have we covered then, lads? Have we covered the Group B? Have we England? Yeah. Wales, of course. The mighty Wales. Slovakia and Russia. You were right, weren't you, with your predictions?
No, I thought Russia would do much better, but we'll forget about that.
Okay.
Yeah. But, I think we've talked about England enough now, so we can move on.
Yeah, fair enough. All right, then. Let's move on. Here we go with Group C, girls and boys. Who was in Group C? Remind us, Poland, Northern Ireland, Germany and the Ukraine. Here we go.
I think Northern Ireland, they're matching up. They have a lot of quality, but they're a good, tough side, and they show a lot of character qualifying, but they are in a tough group. For me, Germany, again, one of the teams to beat. Poland are a very good side. I remember watching them in one of their qualifiers against Republic of Ireland, and the Republic of Ireland are very similar to the North, very well-organised side, and Poland impressed me. And I think Germany could have a run for their money for the top spot with Poland, so it might seem doom and gloom for Northern Ireland, but again, I'm not a fan of Ukraine. So I think Northern Ireland can qualify for the last 16 by taking third place.
I have a different view on that. I think Northern Ireland are going to be the whipping boys in the group. I think they'll be lucky to get a point.
Yeah, really?
I don't want to upset all my friends over in Belfast there. I think Northern Ireland did very well to qualify top in their qualification group, but if they can get qualified for the knockout stages, I will be very amazed. I think I would actually predict, I think they might come away with no points in this group. I know Rob doesn't agree. I think Germany and Poland will dominate this group and be the top two.
Are you very amazed,
Chris? No, well, yeah, well, I would say I've got that spot on, so I'll just say to all those people who mocked me on social media for my predictions...
they did get
listen and weep is what I'll say.
They just like any excuse to mock you, Rob, actually.
All right, well, thank you. Yeah, it's just what I need to hear.
I said Northern Ireland wouldn't qualify. They did only win one game and they only scored in one match. But they did well. They did well to go through. I think obviously Ukraine turned out to be the worst team in the tournament. But I think it was no surprise to see Germany and Poland go through as the top two in that one.
Yeah,
it was pretty easy to predict.
Yeah, so it was basically between Northern Ireland.
Yeah, and Ukraine for the third place, yeah, which Rob got right.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah, so you win a fudge.
Finger of fudge is all Rob needs.
I've written that down, so I won't forget before I leave.
Oh, brilliant. I was going to nip to the shop and buy this lad a fudge. All right, we'll have the news, and then we'll come back with groups D, E and F, of course. And we're going to have a little chit-chat later about whether Wrexham should have had a fan zone. If you'd like to get in contact with me, Andy Snowden at Callon FM, Stage and Screen on Facebook, do that.
Community Radio on 105 FM and online. This is Callon FM.
From the Sky News Centre at 2.
105 FM, uniting our community.
Brace yourself. It's Andy Snowden, stage and screen. Stage and screen.
Go ahead, make my day.
Mrs. Robinson, you're trying to seduce me.
And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay upon thee.
You ever seen a grown man naked?
Here's Johnny.
Life is a box of chocolates, Forrest. You never know what you're gonna get. Tell me about it. Stir.
We want you so. Yeah.
So there you go, they're called the Roseville Band, and they originate from Wrexham Town. Terrific band, them, terrific band. The lads are really enjoying it. You enjoying those lads?
Yeah, they were the first time I heard of them, and very good indeed, very impressed. Yeah,
excellent.
Yeah, no, excellent young group.
There you go. If you get yourself on YouTube, incidentally, you'll be able to see one of their concerts that they did at the Catherine Finch Theatre here in Wrexham. It was streamed live on the internet, and it's well worth a watch, it really is. Now, I've got to say, last Saturday, I think the world of entertainment was rocked by the news of the death of Caroline Ahern, and only 52, absolutely shocking. And, so I've put this little thing together for her. It's, this is for her.
That reminds me, ma'am. Can little David stay over here on Friday?
Oh, yeah, of course he can. What time till?
Till Monday.
I would like to leave this city. This old town don't smell too pretty. And I can feel the warning signs running around my mind.
Welcome, Debbie McGee. But what first, Debbie, attracted you to the millionaire Paul Daniels? Will you welcome old Big Mouth himself, Bernard Manning? Would you know something, Bernard? I came to your club once, the Embassy.
Did you?
And you know, I laughed. Yes. It was the night it burnt down, you know, the fire.
That was the best night I liked, you know.
Please welcome the legendary footballing legend, that is, George Best. But, you know, you were a 60s sensation, weren't you? You know, all that marvellous football you played, and then, of course, all the booze. But did you ever... If you hadn't done all that running around playing football, would you have been as thirsty? Let's have a madcap 5 minutes in the company of award-winning funny man, Steve Coogan. But now, of course, you've started moving on to do characters, haven't you? And you do Alan Partridge, which is a made-up character who hosts a chat show. Mm. That's a very unusual idea, isn't it? But very successful. Mm. Tell me, did you enjoy playing Alan?
Oh, it was great fun. It was great fun. Because, of course, you get to make fun of your guests.
You enjoy that, do you?
Sound familiar?
Running around my mind. Here I go. I'm still scratching around.
What are you going to call her?
Well, myself and my partner and husband, David, decided that there was only one possible name we could choose, and it's a very special name. We've called her Norma.
She's beautiful.
Norma Orchard Tallulah Portia
Best.
To baby Norma!
Where on earth are you from? We're from Wales. Where you come from? Do you put the kettle on?
Callan FM on 105 FM. Kick it.
So I quickly threw that together. I just to explain this. I do sound like I'm drunk. That's because I am. When Wales played Belgium, and I thought, oh, I'm going to put a jingle together, and I ended up doing that. And it's I know. I need to grow up. Anyway, welcome back to the second hour of the show. It's Andy Snowden with music from stage and screen. And today we're having a special show, and I'm a little look back on the Euro 2016. And we have got Councillor Rob Walsh. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon again, Andy.
Fantastic. Hi, here we are. And is good buddy. You two. Oh, I say your name. Craig Jones. Here he is.
Hello there.
And son George.
Hello.
There he is in the corner, behaving himself. Good lads. And how long have you two been mates, do you reckon?
Oh, what's 33 years, you reckon?
30? That's really been our age. Yeah, we met each other when we were one. but no, it's about that now. It is. But yeah, over 30 years,
yeah.
Yes.
No, it's gone quickly, yes.
It's been a while.
Makes you wonder what we've done with our lives.
Yeah.
It's gone that quickly,
Definitely. Yes, we still get on okay.
Yeah, okay.
Do you argue much?
No, it's... I get the mick taken out of me all the time, but I've had years of practice there, I suppose. But now it goes back to when we were in Clyde Park Junior School, and I went through Darland, and all these years just flown by. So. Yeah.
Well, and here we are now.
And here we are, talking on the radio. And I did say earlier, if anybody wanted to ask these lads a question about the Euros, as they are, pretty much experts now. That's, that's what you'd be called if you were on this morning. You would definitely be experts. anything about the Euros, anything about Wrexham's fan zone, just get in contact with me, Andy Snowden, on Callan FM Stage and Screen. It's all free. And we have actually got one question from Sarah Howard. Do you know her? Sarah Howard, H-O-W-A-R-D, Howard.
Yeah, I recognise that name.
I don't know who she is.
I've never heard of her.
Oh, yes. Sorry, it's my current partner.
Oh, it's your current partner, nice. That's it, yeah. Oh, she said, are you going to give me a shout-out, putting up with all your watching football for all 52 games?
Yeah. Well, I have to correct her. It's actually only 51. She should know that, because I reminded her.
That's disgusting.
But, I've been quite good. I have. Rob will kill me for this. I have actually missed a few. To do my good gentlemanly deeds.
What?
That's what just visiting.
Oh, you're talking about going out, right?
Yes.
Let's just take 2 minutes to get over that. Okay, I was sweating there, and I was horrible.
I didn't phrase that properly. Just, you know, going out, the pictures.
Oh, concerts.
Them sort of thing.
Yeah.
Stereophonics. Yeah, Miss Germany, Italy for that.
Oh, mate. Oh, you're lucky.
Yeah.
Anyway, talking of which, let's crack on with Group D. We're up to, aren't we? And what we're doing is we're having a little look back on the chat that we had right at the beginning of the tournament. And the lads gave us their predictions. And here we go with, we're up to Group D between Turkey, Croatia, Spain and the Czech Republic. Ooh, you're nervous. You should be. Here they come.
Group D, it looks quite an interesting group. I don't really rate the Czech Republic in this. I haven't heard a lot about them, and I don't think they're going to be one of the main contenders for this. I think the two big boys in the group are Spain and Croatia.
Yeah.
I think Croatia have got a very, very good side, and Spain, there's been some sort of doubts about whether they'll be good enough to win this, but they've left a lot of good players at home, so it makes me think they'll have a very good chance again. So I think it'll be between Spain and Croatia for the group, with Turkey picking up the consolation third place, really.
Right, OK. You agree with that, yeah?
I certainly agree that Spain and Croatia are the best two sides in the group. The Czech Republic and Turkey, again, I think two of the weaker sides in the tournament. I think the fact that Tomáš Rosický is still playing for the Czech Republic smacks of desperation on their behalf. Croatia, I agree. Croatia are dark horses for this tournament, so they're a side to watch. Spain, I think, might just edge the group. Spain can win it, but they were so dismal in the World Cup 2 years ago, and clearly a lot of their top players from last time are not in the same form or are not playing internationally anymore. So for Spain to win their third consecutive Euro tournament, I think it's going to be tricky. So, but I still think they should top the group here.
So there you go. Did you agree with what you said?
I think we were more or less spot on with that. I'd go see Croatia top the group, which wasn't a surprise, but obviously it changed the dynamics for the next round. But the frustrating thing I found was I thought both sides were brilliant in their opening few games. Like, Croatia threw away 2 points against the Czech Republic, a match they should have easily won, but they didn't. And I thought the Czech Republic and Turkey were quite poor anyway. But I think the sad thing is, as they moved on, Croatia, who I think could have done very well, what happened to them against in the second round against Portugal? That's for me, it's got to be the biggest mystery going, because they just didn't turn up. And the same with Spain against Italy. So two sides who looked really impressive in the group stages really messed up and didn't turn up for the last 16. So it was very disappointing there.
Yeah. Spain were a bit what's the word? Off.
Yeah, especially in the next. Yeah, they. But both sides really did play well in the group, as Rob said, and I actually fancied Croatia to end up going a lot further than they actually did. You know, I think on another day they could have easily got through to probably the final tonight if they'd have carried their form forward from the group. Really.
Yeah. Very odd. Right, should we go to Group E?
It's
pretty much exhausted that one, didn't we? Group E, and that is obviously between the Republic of Ireland. We've got some interest, lads. Sweden, Belgium, and Italy. And here they come.
This is the group of death, I think, because obviously the group of death was the hardest group out of the six. Again, this is going to be dominated by Belgium and Italy. Belgium, everyone should be familiar with the Belgian players. There's probably more quality Belgian players in the Premier League than there are English players.
Yeah.
But I still feel this side has underachieved. I expect them to win this group just from Italy, but they should. They've got to be contenders to win the whole thing, but I just don't think they found that extra gear which can go on and dominate European and world football. Italy, I do feel, probably one of the weaker Italian sides we've had, but Italy always do well when they're under the cosh. So I'll put Italy as dark horses for this tournament, because people are writing them off, but they have a long, proud history. So watch Italy. And Republic of Ireland, what Martin O'Neill and Roy Keane have done has been fantastic. And I think they can get to the last 16 with the third place. And I do think Sweden only just scrape qualification. I think this is one of the weakest Swedish sides I've got. I know they've got Abramovich, but But Sweden, Roman I can't pronounce it. Ibrahimovic, I do apologize. Ibrahimovic.
Yeah.
Sweden, I just think, are a very weak side. So I expect Belgium, Italy, and the Republic of Ireland all to go through from there.
Good. It's a good group, that, actually.
It's a fantastic group.
I didn't really look at that one before. Belgium, Italy, Republic of Ireland, and Sweden.
No, it's been dubbed as the group of death. I think, sort of keeping it brief, I think it's going to be quite tight. I think Republic of Ireland might struggle, but I don't know, really. I think there's chances for any of the four to qualify from this, really. But I've gone for Belgium and Sweden to finish in the top two.
Not Italy.
I know Rob obviously disagrees.
Very much so.
But I think it could be very close. I've actually got Republic of Ireland going out in this.
There you go. What do you reckon?
Ha ha, Craig James.
You were wrong.
I think that's... on the whole, I think based on my comments were pretty accurate. Italy did far better than I said. You know, I said they were dark horses, but I think they were very impressive. And Belgium clearly didn't turn up for their first match against Italy. And Italy won that fair and square. But after that, Belgium, I think, found form. I think that's when they went on beat Ireland and Sweden and then Hungary later on. I thought, no, this team's going to win it here, but we all know what happened to them, and it was no fluke, but I'm certainly not complaining about that. Ireland, again, showed real character getting through, and I knew they would, but I think they were a little bit lucky, the fact they beat Italy once Italy had already qualified.
Yeah.
So now I'm quite happy with my predictions, that group.
Yeah. Yeah, yours?
No. I didn't think Italy would do as well as they thought, and I thought Sweden would do much better, but... you can't get them all right, Andy, as you know.
You can't, mate.
I must have had at least one out of the five right, so...
Yeah. And as we were just talking then a little bit about the Belgium match against Wales, we ever so slightly touched on it, just for larks. Should we have a listen to it?
Yeah. Yes, please.
Here we go, lads. Hold on to your hats.
Callan FM on 105 FM. Uniting our community.
Towards Robson, Carney, Taylor's available. What a turn! What a goal! What a goal from Hal Robson Carney! In towards Vokes. Vokes! Wales are heading into the semi-final of the European Championship. They've taken on Belgium and they have surely beaten them. Another late goal. Another substitute.
Callan FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
Right, I'll tell you now, it's probably the best match I've ever seen in my life, and I'm a Liverpool fan, so I've experienced, Liverpool in Istanbul, right? That, for me, Wales against Belgium, I have never been so excited about a football match. Yeah. I couldn't scream loud enough. It was the most bizarre thing. It's like being in a nightmare, where you wanted to go, ah, ah, and I wanted everybody to hear me, and the only people who could hear me were the people in our front room.
And
we're all doing the same.
I just thought, for me, it's my favourite match of the tournament. I know I'm slightly biased with it being a Wales victory.
Well, go on. I think you're allowed to be.
It's just that in the build-up, sort of an hour before kick-off, I was sort of thinking to myself, they've done really well, Wales, to get to the quarter-finals.
Yeah.
It was sort of, I think a lot of Welsh fans felt at the time, well, if we go out, we go out, at least we can hold our heads up high.
Yeah.
Never, I thought at most we might sneak through, with a free kick or on penalties or something. But yeah. The performance and everything about it, like the whole night, like I was out in Cytherin in town watching it, and the atmosphere was absolutely unbelievable. And it's strange, really, with everyone out on the streets afterwards celebrating, it almost felt like that, Wales had reached the pinnacle. It almost felt like they had won the final then.
Yeah.
It's weird because I wasn't as excited for the semi-final as I was for the match against Belgium. I don't know why.
Yeah.
It's sort of,
before, you mean?
Yeah, sorry, before, yeah. And it's sort of as if that night couldn't have been topped, really. But everything about the performance, the goals, you know, you've got players like Hal Robson-Kanu who has not even got a club, doing things that, you know, like world-class things. And
Liverpool will have him.
And it was just brilliant because they... Because the first 10 minutes, Belgium looked... I was getting a bit worried, but after that...
Because let's face it, their goal was awesome, wasn't it? That first goal, and I just thought, oh, here we go. But as you say, we'd all resigned ourselves before the match that this was going to be the last match.
I think it was, no, and that's what was so great about it, because Belgium, they came off a good 4-0 win against Hungary, and I just thought, they've clicked now, and I thought they were going to go all the way. And what makes the result even better was, some people might say, people who watch might say, oh, Belgium bottle it, Belgium didn't turn up. They did turn up, turned up, and they were still beaten, and that's the great thing. And that's why I was so proud of the Welsh team, they gave everything, they stood toe-to-toe with the Belgian players at their best, and they still won. And as for Robson-Kanu's goal, I know everyone said this, including Robbie Savage on commentary, if that had been done by Messi, if Messi had scored identical goal, people would have been going on about that, and it would be shown again and again and again. But that was just awesome.
It was
fantastic. But I totally agree, best game of the tournament.
Along with when Wrexham beat Arsenal over 20 years ago, definitely the proudest I've been watching football. Just fantastic.
But it kick-started the whole thing off for me again, because after, just get political for Rob, after the EU referendum, everything just sort of like, you know, going over to Europe to watch a football match, you know, whichever way you voted, whichever way it was, you could sit, I mean, the country was sort of... There was a little flat, you know. It's just, oh god, all right. But then this, I mean, I was almost crying. I mean, it was that emotional watching it, you know. I mean, I don't know what I'd have been like in the South Sudan. Talking of which, you know, we've had a question from an Emma Griffiths on Facebook, and she said, I'd like to ask Craig if he realised that he had a nervous twitch whilst watching the football. Many people at the South Sudan have commented on his strange leg twitch. Do you know what that means?
I think now they're talking about just especially for the Belgium match. Mm. The last half hour was absolutely horrible, and because I didn't have a seat in there, I was standing up. But whereas most people can stand still, I was just bobbing one of my legs up and down. Anything to sort of. I was always trying to make time go quicker, I think.
I think that was the worst thing about that second goal. If it had come a little bit later, it would have made life a lot easier for us watching it. What thinking, all right, we're 2-1 ahead, but there's 25 minutes to go.
It was horrible.
It's almost torture, wasn't it?
I know.
And I thought, I've been looking forward to watching the match all day, but I just want it over now.
Exactly. I just wanted it to end.
Anything else to say? Or should we get some comments from our younger viewers? What did you think of the Wales-Belgium match?
Best match I've ever seen.
Definitely.
It brought even young George to tears at the end. He's never cried with happiness before, I don't think, apart from when he watched E.T.
Oh, yes.
Or is that,
It's not a happy sad, isn't it?
Yeah, but, he even got all emotional. It was really, really good.
Well, in our house, we had a special thing. If it wasn't for this, I don't think Wales would have got as far. But Rebecca, luckily, who's here now, every time she nipped to the toilet, we scored. And so she ran. It was quite funny, actually, wasn't it? When the second girl, she nipped to the toilet, and she sort of ran back in, going, oh, I can't believe it! So then, all the way through the Portugal match, we're going, go to the toilet! absolutely brilliant. I don't know what's going to top that for me, though, as an experience. Obviously, you know, games will be great, and games will be, you know, we'll get good scores and all the rest of it. But for emotion and everything else, I mean, people who go, oh, it's just a game. You know, even my wife, Janet, we all know Janet, and she said to me, she went, you know, I hate football. football, but I love that, she said.
Callan FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
Right then, we will finish this little piece then with Group F. We've got ladies and gents, Austria, Hungary, Portugal and Iceland. Are you ready? Are you ready for this?
I think on paper, Portugal are probably the team everyone would think would walk the group, but they might not have it all their own way. I think Austria have got a very good side. Hungary and Iceland, I don't know a lot about. This is Iceland's first appearance in a major tournament, and they did very well in qualification. I do think Portugal, with having the Ronaldo factor, will be good enough to qualify, but I also think Austria will give a good account in this group, and then we'll see what happens with Hungary and Iceland.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah. This has got to be the weakest group of the tournament. I think Portugal are a side on the decline, and I can't see them progressing far in this tour as a whole. But having said that, they must have been laughing their socks off when this draw came in, because this is a very, very weak group. I always remember 8 years ago, in Euro 2008, Austria, they were regarded as the worst host nation to ever perform in the Euros, and I thought that was a bit harsh, but the reality was they were. But they're a much better side now. So I think Portugal should top a weak group, with Austria coming second, and I think Hungary and Iceland, I just don't think can mix it to this level, so I think they're out.
Callan FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
So there you go.
Right, I don't know what to say about that. well, basically, I predicted Portugal to win, and Portugal completely messed up, only just squeezing through in, well, in one of, another one of the best games of this tour was the 3-3 with Hungary.
Yeah.
And they're very lucky to get through, and then the unthinkables happened. They got to the final, and I think they've played poor, and I'm sure the Portuguese players are scratching their heads thinking, how the hell have we got this far? Because yeah, the match, we talked about the best game of the tournament, the worst game of the tour by a mile was Portugal v Croatia. That was painful to watch.
Yeah, it was.
It was that bad.
Yeah.
And then Portugal, they sneak past Poland. I think that they beat Wales. I think Wales had given everything against Belgium. I just think they were tired then. And I think that's how Portugal just had that extra momentum. And they play France in the final tomorrow. The way things have gone, you never know with Portugal, but surely they're not going to win. France are going to win this quite comfortably. But some of the other side, Hungary, very impressed with Hungary. I don't think one of the better sides, but they battled on into the last 16. Iceland, again, great battles. Even when they got hammered by France the other day, they still showed character in the second half.
Yeah.
And the less said about Austria, the better. So that's me done.
Craig?
No, I think after the group stages, if someone had said Portugal would end up in the final, I would have been really shocked. But they've ground out results, and it may not be the prettiest football, but, you know, I think, you know, the teams they beat in the knockout stages, they deserve to be, like, even though I hate to admit it, they did deserve to beat Wales the other night. Although it was pretty close, they were the best side on the night.
Yeah.
But them getting to the final is unbelievable. It could be a case of, because ironically, when they hosted it, they lost in the final against Greece, and maybe they got the chance to redeem themselves in the final playing the host this time and defeating them. So, and we also seem to have a shock winner every 12 years in this tournament. I'm using a Walsh stat for you here. But like 12 years ago, Greece won it, which nobody expected, and 12 years before that was the famous Denmark victory.
Oh.
When they only found out they were in the tournament about 10 days before. So, if we're looking at 12-year patterns, yeah,
and you also say 12 years before Euro 92 and Euro 1980, the winners were Germany, who were the favourites. So,
exactly.
it might revert back to time.
It only started in 92.
And also, we've got a France-Portugal final, and France-Portugal ties have often been very dramatic, either because of the the goals or the controversy, because one of the best matches of all time was the semi-final between France and Portugal in Euro 84. Fantastic. I do can remember the scenes for the France-Portugal semi-final in Euro 2000 when France had a penalty in the last minute of extra time. And I think, was it half the Portuguese side was sent off because of their behaviour?
Something like that,
it was absolutely bizarre. But having said that, I still hope Portugal do well. I've actually got Portugal in the Fly Welfare sweepstake, and I actually visited Portugal in May, one of my beautiful countries. So if they do it, I will be happy.
All right. Well, go on then. I'll push you for a prediction for the final then.
You're in the final tomorrow. It's... I'm still gonna say France are gonna win. I don't think France have been absolutely outstanding in this tournament. The defence looks a bit dodgy, but I think if they could overcome Germany, because I expected them to lose the semi-final.
Yeah.
Although playing Portugal will be a different game, I think Portugal will be far more defensive. I think possibly could have the makings of a poor final. I hope I'm wrong. What we need is an early goal, but I think Portugal's tactic is going to be like they did against Poland, keep it tight and hope they get the odd goal or even take it to penalties.
Yeah.
But I think if either side gets an early goal, it'll open it up a bit. But I'm going to stick with France to be Portugal. I think they would deserve it on what they've done in the tournament so far.
All right, fair enough.
Yeah, if we're going to go by logic, I've been impressed with France last two games. I think they've really clicked into gear. Surely France will win this 2-0 or 3-0. But this tournament, logic and Portugal have not gone hand in hand. So you never know. But it'd be nice if Portugal won. But really, you've got to expect it to be France.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So two France wins?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right then. Fair enough. Right, coming up after this, we are going to have the big debate from Wrexham. Why on earth didn't we get a fan zone?
Callan FM on 105 FM, uniting our community.
Right, so if you want to get in contact with us and ask these lads a question, or specifically I would say Councillor Rob Walsh, actually, because he's probably going to be the geezer that can help you. Get in contact with me, Andy Snowden, at Callan FM Stage and Screen, and put your questions to the lads. Go on, I dare you.
Take a chance.
the manic preachers. Take two. The manic street preachers. There you go. If you tolerate this, yeah, kids are my next. Which is very appropriate for our next discussion. We are going to be talking about this this big thing that went on after Wales got through of the group stages into the last 16. Everybody was calling out for a fan zone to be erected somewhere in Wrexham town, and all sorts of excuses from the council why they couldn't do it. And there was uproar, lads. There was uproar.
There was
indeed.
I know it's been.
I'll tell you what. I'll put your mic up.
Oh, thank you.
Tell you, that's better.
No, it's been a big talking point. I've seen letters in the local papers and comments on social media and the internet. Firstly, I will say, I think because Wales weren't, nobody expected Wales to do as well as they did.
Yeah.
And for perhaps the town of Wrexham to come together before the tournament started. Like, there was no mention, well, I certainly didn't see anyone mention, oh, should we get a fan zone set up for, you know, the group games? I'm sure somebody did come up with the idea, but I didn't see it myself.
Yeah.
But obviously when they went qualified and went through, I saw a lot of people talking about it. And, you know, the fact that Wales had three knockout games, so... you know, I'm sure that there would have been plenty of time to get something organised.
Yeah.
Because you see pictures from South Wales. I believe they even did it in other parts of North Wales, in Anglesey and Colwyn Bay, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
And I think what's good about having fan zones is the atmosphere, like I've seen it myself, the atmosphere in the pubs in Wrexham is very good. But as I experienced for the Belgium match, it was really, really packed and almost impossible to get served at the bar.
Yeah.
And I think one thing as well with my son George here, I know people could say, oh, but you could have stayed at home and watched with him. But
yeah.
I wanted to go out and enjoy the atmosphere and have a couple of pints and watch it. And, you know, I couldn't really take him with me. Now, had there been a fan zone, families and the like could have got together and all enjoyed it, and it would have really created a good atmosphere, because what I saw for the Northern Ireland, the match against Belgium, and even when they lost against Portugal the other night, you know, everyone spilling out onto the streets, especially on High Street.
Yeah.
And it was just fantastic. You know, I've never experienced anything like it in Wrexham.
No.
I think a lot of people would never have seen all people coming together. You know, there's... I've never kissed so many strangers in my life as in the last 2 weeks.
Don't lie.
Mostly men, I must add. But, it was brilliant to be a part of. And I just think if, you know, Wrexham Council... I know they would have only had a short space of time to organise something.
Yeah.
But if everywhere else could organise something, you know, surely it's something that could have been done. And I think it would have looked really good on them. And because your typical man in the street's always moaning about, oh,
yeah,
Wrexham never organises anything good, or they're not bothered.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think it would have been... you know, it might have changed people's opinions.
Yeah.
Now, although Wales did really well and most Welsh fans have enjoyed the tournament, it's, you know, that's sort of been the sore point of the whole thing. It's like, why does everyone else do something and Wrexham never does? You know, you hear lots of people saying that.
Well, what's the official take on it? Why couldn't they do it?
Right, there were a few issues as far as I'm aware, because really... must admit, this didn't really come to my attention until about 2 or 3 weeks ago. Because obviously, I mean, fan zones would have been great, but it was never the first thing on my mind. Now, the first really I heard about it, and I've been led to believe since that others said they've asked, but first time was one of my colleagues, Councillor Brian Cameron. local member for Whitegate. He brought a question to the council chamber on the 21st of June asking for a fan zone. And the response which came from the lead member for the local economy, Councillor Neil Rogers, was again that the events team which puts on which would put on a fan zone, that's been reduced over the past year due to council cutbacks, and then we just wouldn't have the time to arrange it. But there have been other reasons as well. I think there was a concern that, and it's a valid concern, that it would have taken away businesses, trade from businesses, from pubs, etc. And then there was a last-ditch attempt where the council and other local organisers tried to put something on, but it was vetoed by the Safety Advisory Board, which is made up of the police, the fire service, ambulances, etc. Now, I don't know what their reasons were for stopping this or recommended that this couldn't go ahead, but if they say no, it would be a very brave call to turn around and say, well, we're going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
I think the basic thing is that and even though I'm a member of Wrexham Council, I'm not part of the council's executive who makes these decisions. Having said that, I'm not trying to point the finger of blame at them, because basically if I'd really wanted a fan zone, I could have stood in the council chamber months ago and campaigned for this, but I didn't because I simply didn't think about it. And I think that's what's happened is nobody thought that far ahead. And it's simple as that.
Yeah.
But I think that we've all learned lessons from this. I know I certainly have. And one of the things I will be doing is, touch wood, if Wales qualify for the next World Cup, I will start campaigning from that moment that we get fan zone set up in Wrexham for the 2018 World Cup. And I know there are a lot of people angry out there, quite rightfully so. But I just think that it was just lack of foresight. And we've just got to learn from this.
I think as well. I mean, from the to be fair to the council, I think people who didn't really know what was what it took. I mean, they just thought you could put a screen up and let everybody go around and watch it like you were going to stand in front of a telly. But I went to they were going to put it by the library, weren't they? That was the plan. Yeah. And I walked past there yesterday, and I thought, God, they would have had to cut this bit off. They would have had to put barricades here. Mm-hmm. They would have had to arrange places where people could eat stuff, go to the toilet, all that messing about. Mm. Although I thought my argument was, if say for argument's sake the Queen came to town, if they phoned up and said the Queen's coming on Wednesday, put a great big screen up and organise security, they'd do it. Right, and that's just for the Queen coming. And if they can't do that for almost everybody in the council, in the county or in Wrexham that wanted to go and see it, it did seem a little bit, you know, to me, I think you could do it, right? Yeah. But and they chose not to. That's what I thought.
Yeah, well, I think obviously the issue is if the Queen did come for an emergency, I think that basically other emergency services from other areas would have come as backup, and obviously you'd have the Secret Service come in to make sure security was tight.
Yeah.
But that was never going to happen for a Wrexham fan zone. I agree with the public in the fact there should have been one. There really should have been one. I know people have said that, well, Rill did it, Mole did it, why couldn't have Wrexham? And my answer is simply, I don't know, because I don't know how Denbighshire and Flintshire councils operate.
They could also not predict how many people were going to turn up.
Well, that's true, yeah. And I don't know the reasons for this, because I've never seen any minutes from that meeting. But in my current position, I cannot say whether the safety advisory group were right or wrong, because I don't know their reason. But all I do know is you ignore that your peril. So if I'd been leader of the council or a lead member, and could I have made that call and said, sod it, we're going to have a fan zone anyway? I don't know if I could have. But all I can say to the public, who are very angry and rightfully so, is I've learnt lessons. I'm sure other councillors have learnt lessons from this as well. And we'll try not to make the same mistakes again in the future.
Yeah. Well, I now, obviously, you can't do anything different, can you?
Yeah,
but, I mean,
no.
It's just a bit of a shame, really. But, I mean, anybody that's seen the you know, the, all the lads and lasses singing outside the pubs in town, and although to be fair, you might be hard pushed to know if that was actually a riot or people enjoying themselves. Yeah. You know, I mean, if you're a little old lady walking through town at that point, you might have been a bit scared, but. Everybody that was there said everybody was immaculately behaved. It was just a really good time. Yeah. Blokes kissing each other, as Craig's already said. Yeah. And,
I think it's fair to say, fair play to the Welsh fans, both in Wrexham, throughout all of Wales, and those who travel to France. The word is, all have been immaculate, and we should be very, very proud of them.
Yeah, because I've really been proud of how the people of Wrexham have actually taken to the Welsh side.
Yeah.
Because I do see it quite often, mainly just for the rugby matches. Like, I've been out and about for the Six Nations, and Wrexham's got a very much strong rugby union following where everyone goes out in their Welsh shirts. But to see it for the football, obviously I've been out with people watching Wales playing football in the past, but it was really something special this time, and I think in my lifetime I've never seen scenes like it, especially after the Belgian match. It was, you know, I didn't want the night to end, really. It was brilliant.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. Hey, listen, lads, I know we said we were going to chat for 2 hours. That's unbelievably, we've run out of time. but what I would say is, can I book you for 2018? Is that all right?
Yes.
Can we do it again?
Absolutely. Yes.
We'll be back in 4 years.
Hopefully, Wales will qualify. Famous last words. I've looked at the qualifying group Wales have, and it looks reasonably straightforward, but yeah. I don't know why I've jinxed them by saying
because
that.
It all starts in September for the World Cup, and so let's fingers crossed. Wales have got 10 games, so they have to win the group this time to make sure they qualify. So let's hope they can get to Russia and
And so you'll have to find the theme tune to a Russian sitcom as the backing music.
Fantastic. Thanks, Rob.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, young George. There we go. Oh, you didn't make your point, mate. Hang on a minute. What was going to be your point about the fans, though?
I just think that I don't see any reason.
He's eating a sweet. We'll give him a minute to swallow it. Hang on. Oh, and all around my hat for a 12-month and a day. And if anyone should ask me the reason why, it's all for my true love, who's far, far away. Fare thee well, cold winter, and fare thee well, cold frost. And nothing have I gained, but my own true love I've lost. I'll sing and I'll be merry when occasion I deceive. Jesus, the false, deluded young girl. Have you finished your sweet?
Yeah.
Right, here he comes. Here's George Jones. Here he comes. Go.
I just don't really see why there was not a fan zone. Like, on the high street, if there'd have been a screen, it was basically a fan zone in itself.
But
if they'd set it up properly, I just think that it'd have been a much better experience. And there's probably a fan zone in Iceland, and Wrexham's got a bigger population than Iceland anyway, so...
Nice.
Yeah, now, I agree with the inside there, George. We've got to live and learn, so hopefully next time...
They won't make the same mistake again. If Wales qualify for the World Cup, I'm sure things will be organised way in advance.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll probably have fan zones in Clyde, Gresford, Rosses, etc. Rostoffland,
Kygo.
Can I just say, if anybody was offended by Rob's language there, grow up. The green all around.
Status Quo's manager, Simon Porter, has said that Rick Parfitt is now making an excellent and steady recovery after an extremely serious life-threatening situation following a Quo show in Turkey last month. And he's now on a defibrillator fitted into his chest, oh my God, in order to regulate his future heart issues. And he's left hospital and he's recuperating at home with family and friends. There we go. We must say that he's not going to be on tour with the Quo over the summer, but bass player John Ryan O'Edwards' son is continuing to step into this fold, and his name's Freddie Edwards, and he's going to be stepping in, and he's understudy for Rick Parfitt, he is. Right then, coming up at Theatre Clwyd on the 15th and 16th of July, the long-established Shirley School of Dancing take to the stage at Theatre Clwyd for their annual song and dance spectacular Dancerama. And once again, the show is a lively performance which features enthusiastic singers and dancers of all ages, from the very young to the young at heart. I popped down to last-minute rehearsals at the Institute in Harden to see for myself why this dancing school is highly regarded as the best dance academy in North Wales. And I managed to catch a word with the principal, Shirley Snowden, and one of her senior choreographers, Nadine North, and some of the cast, who were obviously very excited about their latest production. And I started by asking simply, how do they go about getting putting a dance together? And is what they had to say.
Yeah, they usually make something up at home, and they'll have an idea in their head of what they want to do. They'll make it up at home, and then they'll come in and they'll teach it to the class, and then they'll decide the places and move people. And
do other people come in with ideas?
Usually people are a bit afraid to give their ideas in case they look like they're being a bit cheeky, but this year people have actually put in their ideas. Oh, it would be good if we had this, or it would be good if we had that. And some people, my friend Amelia has a type of band she likes, and they have a very good style of dance, and she showed some of it, and then that's gone in the opening number.
And you're not just dancing this year, are you? You're going to be singing as well?
Yeah, singing as well, yeah.
What? Who do you sing with?
My mum, brother and sister.
All right, what are you singing this year?
We are singing the Baseballs version of The Look.
Like a man, I hate it like a hammer. She's a cherry blossom, scum, never was a critter. Kissing like a raindrop, she's got the look. She's got the look. Back, cause everyone's got a number when she's turning me around. The kiss me as a collar, love me as a wild dog. She's got the look.
She's got the look.
She's got the look.
She's got the look.
She's got the look. What in the world can make a brighter girl turn blue? When anything I ever do, I do for you. And I go la 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 la. She's got the look.
So when did you start this dancing school?
When I was 16.
And just you on your own, or...?
Yeah, well, my mum used to always come and take the money for me.
Right.
We was in a little hut in Mancot, opposite the maternity home.
Was it always called the Shirley School of Dancing?
Yeah, from the word go.
Right, OK. Yeah. And was there anybody else? Because obviously it's a family-run thing.
Yeah, my sister used to help me, but it was always the Shirley School of Dancing.
Yeah.
She did it for quite a while.
But now her daughter is one
her
of the main teachers.
Her daughter and her granddaughter.
Yeah.
Her niece.
So it is quite a big family, yeah. Family-run affair.
Yeah.
And what about your brother as well? Because he did the ballroom, didn't he?
He did the ballroom dancing.
Right.
And he represented North Wales in from dancing. And he danced with his wife. Yeah.
A massive thing now in them days.
Brilliant.
In the 70s.
Yeah.
So how many years have you been at Theatre Clwyd then?
88 we started,
wasn't it?
Was it 88?
Yeah.
88, right.
It's nearly 30.
Yeah,
30 years.
All right. And what is it about Theatre Clwyd that you like?
Well, I think it's nice for the children to go into a proper theatre, because when they do all the rehearsing and the exams, we're in the Harden Institute, and it's a big thing once a year to go into a proper theatre.
So what's your favourite sort of dancing?
Ballet.
You like the ballet?
Yeah.
Why do you like the ballet?
I don't know, it's what I started doing when I came here, so it's the one that stuck with me.
Right. So, do you do the block?
Yeah.
Thing? That looks like it really hurts, does it really hurt?
When you first start, but you get used to it, I guess.
Does it not hurt your feet?
No.
It looks really painful.
You need to make sure you cut your toenails.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
that's not what I thought, actually. I was thinking more around about your ankle. But yeah, I suppose your toenails. Doesn't hurt your legs as well, doesn't it? That must be a nightmare.
You get used to it.
Yeah.
Like, done it for like 3 years now, so quite used to it.
What other dances do you do?
I do tap and freestyle.
I do like it, but not as much as the ballet.
Right, okay. Alright, what do you like most about doing the shows?
They're just like the highlight of the year.
Yeah. Getting to be on stage and...
Yeah.
So we're all with our friends as well. Get to show what we've been doing for last year.
Right, and you'll enjoy dancing?
Yeah.
What's your favourite type of dancing?
I love all of them.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Which is your favourite, do you think?
Probably the disco freestyle one.
Yeah? You like that?
Yeah.
You like a little bit of disco in?
Yeah.
Good. Marvellous. So do you think you're going to be a dancer when you grow up?
I'd like to, yeah.
What's your name?
Libby.
Libby! Come a bit closer to here. Are you looking forward to doing the show?
Yeah.
What do you like most about doing the shows?
Dancing in front of people.
You like dancing in front of people? Do you like showing off?
No.
What, do you get excited going on stage or do you get nervous?
Both.
You're a little bit nervous and a bit excited. Alright, okay. Alright, lovely. And is your mum and dad coming to see the show?
Yeah.
And your nana?
Yeah.
So how long have you been a teacher here now?
21 years.
21 years, and you were obviously a student here before.
I was.
Right, okay. I've always wanted to know, because a lot of your dances, they're so out there. Every year you do something completely different. Where did you come up with the ideas?
Well, I like to be original.
Right.
I don't like to do anything like anybody else. I like my own little ways and things, so...
Do you ever see something on the telly and go, I'm going to do that?
I see certain things on the telly and get a little bit of inspiration from them.
Right.
But I also get inspiration from just basically seeing things on an everyday basis.
Is your main thing tap? Would I be correct in
it
that?
It is tap, right. Yeah. I'm a theatrical dancer rather than a classical dancer.
And where did you train?
Merseyside Dance Drama Centre, after I left here at 16 and then came back after I passed my teachers to teach. She's got the look.
She's got the look. So there you go, that's the Shirley School of Dancing, going to be on stage at Theatre Clwyd on the 15th and 16th of July. And also, I would like to say congratulations to Janine and her other half, Scott, who are getting married today. Actually, thinking about it, they're already married, unless one of them did a runner. They got married in the Lion Keys today, and she wanted me to play A Thousand Years by the beautiful Christine Perry. Here we go. Hey, listen, chaps, you take care of yourselves. I'll see you next week. Say that again.
Thank you very much, Andy. Much appreciated. Glad to be here.
Thank you very much.
Marvellous. Take care of yourselves.
Thank you.
Hulvaur.
See you soon.
I'll see you.